think that this is a very quick one. Okay, it's not. Again, I'm going to ask you some questions because so stay online. Or actually, who else is exam going now? Who is acutely exam going? Vivek, you're acutely exam going.
Yes.
Asukta,
yes.
Come in and take some questions. Okay, these are straightforward. Nothing complicated.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Straightforward. So, Vivek, what is the various segments of the media science? Just quickly come back with it. What divides it?
The classical division of media synonym is divided, media synonym is divided into superior and inferior. The dividing line is passing between.
What is the dividing line?
The dividing line passes between the sterno, the manubriosternal angle anteriorly and posteriorly passes below the T4 level, between T4 and T5.
So T4, correct. That is correct. Okay. So that's superior and inferior. So what is the border of anterior? What's the border of middle? What's the border of posterior? This is just a revision, okay? I know all of you know it, but let's just go through it quickly.
So the anterior border, the anterior mediastinum is lined anteriorly by the posterior border of the sternum and posteriorly by the anterior border of the pericardium. The medial mediastinum is lined by the anterior border of pericardium anteriorly and the posterior border of pericardium posteriorly, and posterior mediastinum is behind the posterior pericardium and up to the vertebral body. So this is the classical division of mediastinum.
Okay, that's fine. So we are happy with this. Happy with this. Everybody happy. Above is superior. Below is this thing, and then you've got these three. Okay. Inlet is below the edge of the first rib. That is the inlet, what we spoke about today, okay? The line is angle of Louis to T4. It's the inferior border of T4. That's important to know, okay? And then we've got the prevascular space, the retrovascular space, and the pharyngo, the peripharyngo esophageal space. These are the three names you have to use. So anterior, middle, and posterior mediastinum, okay? These are the three names that you have to use. If I ever ask you, what are the other names for an anterior, middle, and posterior mediastinum? This is what you have to do. Again, what is present in the superior mediastinum? Just really quickly. Today, we won't spend much time on this, but really quickly. Come, Vivek, what's in the superior mediastinum?
Yes, superior mediastinum anteriorly is the thymus, is the left brachiocephalic vein, the thymus gland. That's it. And followed posteriorly by trachea and then esophagus.
No other structures?
And lymph nodes.
Aray baba, aorta ka koi structures aa raha hai ki nahi aa raha hai mediastinum mein? Ki nahi aa raha?
Yes sir, aorta. Arch of aorta will be there in the end.
Yeah, there is arch of aorta comes above that line, slightly above that line, and if there's aneurysm, it will come. Okay? All right.
Yes.
And anything in the esophagus, any masses in the esophagus will come there. So these are the common pathologies, okay? Aortic arch aneurysms, any lymphadenopathy, any tumors from the thymus, germ cell, we've spoken about it, and we've spoken about retrosternal goiter, and we've spoken about parathyroid adenomas. Did you speak about parathyroid adenomas? No. So parathyroid also comes there, okay, sometimes, and you can get parathyroid adenomas and upper esophageal mass. This is important to know these things because differential diagnosis is based on what you see here. So it's important to know everything that is there on this chart. Okay, I'll just try to summarize it. Anterior mediastinum is from sternal and costal cartilages. The posterior is parietal pericardium. Superior is angle of Louis and inferior is diaphragm. So you have to talk about all four borders. Okay?
Yes, sir.
All four borders. Anterior, posterior, superior and inferior.
Yes, sir.
So, these are the things that are present there. Okay? It's quite important. Thymic tumors, lymphadenopathy, germ cell. Again, my question, what are the three commonest lymphadenopathies you get? I showed you in the previous slide.
Tuberculosis, lymphoma.
And sarcoidosis.
Sarcoidosis.
Good. Middle mediastinum is bounded by this. Okay, parietal in front, parietal at the back, angle of Louis up and diaphragm inferiorly. So all four you should talk about, okay? All right, and these are the common things that you see in the middle mediastinum. Okay, tracheal tumors are present in the middle mediastinum. Yeah, okay. And posterior mediastinum is outside of that area. So parietal pericardium and vertebral bodies is the two angles that you have to talk about, the anterior and posterior, okay? And then these are the tumors that you see. These are common tumors. Neurogenic tumors are the commonest. Don't forget enteric cyst. Don't forget esophageal carcinomas and cyst. And diaphragm, don't forget diaphragm. The hernias come in the posterior mediastinum, yeah? And descending aortic aneurysms and meningocele, because sometimes the meningocele can come out and into that area, yeah? So take a shot and differential diagnosis, you should know. This is very, very basic, but still you should know. Okay, in an adult, commonest is nerve sheath, okay? Nerve sheath tumors in the mediastinum. Thymoma is 19%. Cysts are less, lymphomas and germ cell tumors. This is the order of frequency of diagnosis. So commonly you'll see nerve sheath, thymoma, cyst, lymphoma, germ cell. You must know this order. So what is more common, you have to know. Okay? All right. Children, all adult tumors, but specifically you have to talk about foregut duplication tumors, vascular malformations, nerve tumors, mesenchymal tumors, and histiocytosis is a particular disease which affects children. Okay? So this is in children. So don't forget this, okay? Have a look at this and just mention.
Yes, sir.
So these are the various things. We don't want to talk about this. So again, my... Okay, tumor markers. Come on now, guys. This is important to remember. You must know all tumor markers, not just alpha fetoprotein and beta HCG. Many a times I ask this question and people just say alpha fetoprotein and beta HCG. You must know about acetylcholinesterase receptors. You must know about muscle-specific tyrosine kinase. Parathyroid adenomas, you must know about calcium levels. This has got reversed, sorry. Blood smear is very specific for lymphoma and for thyroid function tests for retrothyroid masses. Vivek, in your patient, you did not speak about thyroid function tests. You must mention it when you have an anterior mediastinal pass. So this is important. Take this slide and take a picture of it if you want. But this is important. Whenever I ask you, tell me about tumor markers that you look for in anterior mediastinal tumor, then this should be the answer. The things that you commonly forget are calcium levels and parathyroid adenomas, and you forget about thyroid function and blood smear. These lower three you forget. In fact, a lot of people don't talk about ACH receptors as well. So this is quite a routine shot to show you, okay?
Now, Dr. Khan, just sorry to bother. Can you share these slides with us on the group as well, please?
Yeah. All of this I'm recording this. I'm recording this presentation, so it will go on the YouTube website. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Come to you. Don't worry. Okay, I'm going fast now because this is all routine, and I don't want to spend too much time. And I'm also tired. So Hodgkin's lymphoma is elevated alkaline phosphatase in 50% of patients. Okay. Non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, blood smear. The other area where alkaline phosphatase could be elevated is also in seminomas, okay? So look that up. Non-Hodgkin's lymphoma is neutrophilia. This is the other info. I've just picked up the important things. The one thing which you forgot to say is bone marrow aspiration and biopsy, okay? Bone marrow aspiration and biopsy should be done if you're suspecting lymphomas. So don't forget to say that. When you start your investigations, I think you didn't mention bone marrow aspiration and biopsy. Yeah? It's quite important. Now, alpha fetoprotein, let's go through this. Anybody knows what's the diagnostic level of AFP? What do you mean by elevated? Number, somebody give me a number. Hello?
Actually, both, sir. Both of them 500, both of beta HCG as well as
500 micrograms, that's the correct number, okay? And this is the thing that you have to remember. Remember this chart, take this picture of this chart. And this is important because what is elevated and what is not elevated is important to know. Yeah? Take a picture of this, take a screenshot if you want. But AFP is important because you have to know where it is elevated and where it is not elevated. And the next is beta HCG. And here you need to know what is the difference between the first slide and this slide. So take this picture. Yeah, I'm not going to go into details. You can work it out yourself. Okay. So just take this picture. This is first slide. And this is the next slide. Okay. This is just say these answers and you'll be absolutely fine. There's no problem with it. This is all checked through literature and all that. Yeah. Okay, thank you. Radiology, we spoke about chest X-ray, AP lateral, we spoke about this, we spoke about this. Okay, my next question to you is going to be to Vivek. Vivek, you come in. Vivek, tell me.
Yes, sir.
What are indications for MRI in thoracic surgery?
Indications are when we are suspecting any neural involvement, that is in case of posterior mediastinal tumors, when we are suspecting any intra-spinal extension of the tumor.
So that's that one.
Secondly, in case of, as we saw in the morning, in case of thoracic outlet obstruction, when we are suspecting any brachial plexus involvement, that is a time we would like
to. Two.
Thirdly, when if a CT scan is contraindicated, if the patient is a pregnant lady who needs an imaging study, I would ask for an MRI.
So you spoke about thoracic outlet syndrome, but what about the other way? What about if some that is coming from out thoracic inlet? What about if a tumor is coming from outside, from within the chest, up there?
Yes.
What is that called as?
The PANCOS.
Yeah, PANCOS tumor, thoracic outlet and thoracic inlet tumors. Okay, you need to know the tumors. At the thoracic outlet, you do need an MRI, not a CT scan. Somebody asked me earlier, you know, why would you do an MRI and not a CT? But I would always prefer an MRI. What test would I do in an MRI specifically? For thoracic outlet, what test would I do?
You need the spectroscopy, some...
MR angiography. Okay,
you MR do angiography. Okay.
Okay. You do MR angiography, that's what you need. Not just simple MRI, but MR angiography, because you really need to know invasion of the tumor into the subclavian artery, into the subclavian vein, and you also need to know brachial plexus involvement, okay? Yeah. So that's why you do an MRI. Okay, what is the new indication for MRI in the chest? Any other indications where you do MRI? Any other indications where you would do MRI?
Chest wall involvement.
Chest wall involvement. Okay. Yeah, maybe. I don't know. I really wouldn't do it. A CT is good for that.
I don't know, sir. I can't.
Small thymolipomas.
Thank you very much. Small thymolipomas. That's the new indication. Yeah. In the last meeting of the ITMIC, they said that you do not need to resect every single small lesion in the thymus, okay? Yes. You do not need to resect it. All you need to do is, follow the patient up with a MRI, and they are very sensitive to tell you whether this is turning into a malignancy or not, okay? All right. Yes. This one you forgot, ultrasound testes, okay? And don't forget PET scan. In all malignancies, you're safe to say PET scan. I have no problems if somebody says PET scan. I have a problem when somebody misses a PET scan, to be honest, okay? Not all guidelines are saying that you should do PET scan in all malignancies. But, lung cancer, we know for sure that it's part of the guidelines. But there's nothing wrong in doing it. You would gain more knowledge than not gain knowledge. So if you're specifically asked this question in the exam, just say I'll do it. Because not for primary tumor, but to look for distant metastasis. That's the most important thing, okay? All right. We've spoken about this, we've spoken about all of this, and we don't need to talk more. Types of lymphomas, what are the names I just showed you? Hodgkin's and non-Hodgkin's.
Okay.
Now somebody tell me something a little bit. Two lines about Hodgkin's lymphoma. Come on, Vivek, your exam going.
So the Hodgkin's lymphoma, basically the pathognomonic cell is Reed-Sternberg cell. And there are a few types of Hodgkin's lymphoma. One is the nodular sclerosis, which is most common, followed by a lymphocyte predominant, followed by a lymphocyte depletion, and one is mixed cellularity.
Very good. You seem to know. Well done.
Then out of these, the lymphocyte
predominant... What is the pathology in non-Hodgkin's? Once you finish Hodgkin's, tell me non-Hodgkin's, what's the pathology?
Pathologies...
How do you divide non-Hodgkin's?
it's a B cell or a T cell lymphoma. So in mediastinum, most commonly found is large B cell lymphoma or a lymphoblastic. These are the two most commonly found in mediastinum.
Tell me and, about this.
Ann Arbor system, basically, it's according to the region of the lymphatic involvement. So it is according if there are lymph nodes which are involved in a single region, followed by a non-contiguous involvement. Stage two is when two non-contiguous lymphatic lymph nodes are involved on the same side of diaphragm. Stage three is on both sides of diaphragm, and four is metastatic.
So go through this again, okay, everybody. I'm going slowly, just so that you go through it. A single lymph node or a single lymphoid structure is stage one. Two or more lymph nodes on the same side of the diaphragm is stage two. Lymph nodes or organs on both sides of the diaphragm is stage three. And extranodal sites is stage four. That is why I was so adamant that when you talk about a CT scan, you must talk about lymph nodes, okay? I was upset because you need to talk about lymph nodes because the staging changes completely depending upon what is present, okay? Anybody wants to talk about what are the modifiers on Ann Arbor?
A and B symptoms and no symptoms.
So A is absence of symptoms. B is presence of symptoms. What else?
X.
E is involvement of single, extranodal, contiguous, or proximal to known nodal sites. Okay.
And S is spleen involvement. S is spleen involvement.
What else? I heard Vivek say something just now.
X. I said X. I don't remember.
Yeah. Bulky disease, large deposit more than 10 centimeters.
Yes.
Or one third of thoracic diameter.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Quite simple stuff, but you know it's important. If you know these, you will crack the exam. Left, right, and center, you will crack the exam. Okay. Okay. What's the treatment for Hodgkin's? Anybody knows for treatment for Hodgkin's? What are the guidelines saying?
BEP.
Okay. Radiotherapy or chemoradiotherapy? Okay. For Hodgkin's lymphoma. Surgery is only indicated in persistent pleural effusions for residual disease or in enlarging mass to exclude recurrent disease. Okay. Just take this shot. Again, I'm not going into great detail because I'm feeling tired. So I don't want to talk more. Okay. Is this clear? It's quite a clear slide. There's nothing much to understand here. What is the treatment for non-Hodgkin's lymphoma?
Chemoradiation is the primary line of treatment.
Thank you.
Chemoradiation.
If not patient doesn't want, then there is some role for radiotherapy. What is the indication for surgery in non-Hodgkin's lymphoma?
Only basically for biopsy.
Surgery for persistent pleural effusions, for residual disease, and for enlarging mass. Same indications, okay? They are repeated in non-Hodgkin's as well, okay? Germ cell tumors, just quickly, they are non-seminomatous or seminomatous. The one thing to remember is the commonest syndrome associated with is Klinefelter's. Okay? Just, I wanted to highlight this to you guys, that Klinefelter's is associated with germ cell tumors. Yeah? That's a syndrome association. What is the pathology, histopathology classification?
One is embryonal cell carcinoma, yolk sac tumor.
Teratomas which are mature.
Benign.
First is benign. Okay, first is benign. And that is teratoma and dermoid cyst. Okay?
Yes.
Then what are the malignant ones?
Immature teratoma. Immature tumor, seminoma, non-seminoma.
Teratoma with malignant transformation. Seminoma kidhar aa gaya idhar? We are talking about non-seminomatous germ cell tumor.
Yes.
Embryonal cell, yolk sac, and choriocarcinoma. Okay.
Yes.
Straightforward. Very bang answers. There is no confusion about this. Treatment for non-seminomatous germ cell tumor. Your patient. You want to talk about it?
Chemotherapy.
Yeah, chemotherapy with or without bone marrow transplant. Okay.
There is some suggestion
that BMT helps. If patient's got metastasis, then you got to look at chemo radiotherapy. Okay. That is recommended. But surgery is there for residual disease after chemotherapy for marker negative patient. So your patient, which we were talking about, we will actually give him chemotherapy first line. We will see if there is any role for immunotherapy. We'll see if there is role for second line. And most of the time, the oncologist will tell you that, you know, we'd like you to completely
debulk.
Debulk is not a word to use. You should say you would like to reduce the tumor load. And then if you can go for R0 resection, that's the best thing. Don't say debulking. In the exam, Don't use the word debulking. You'll get into trouble. So, the aim should always be R0 resection. On table, you may do R1, but the aim should always be R0 resection. So don't say debulking, okay?
Okay.
All right. There are two types of seminomas and germinomas, okay? Happy with this? Treatment? Platinum-based chemotherapy. And for small things, surgery followed by radiotherapy, okay? That's it. Thank you very much. I've got another talk here, which I don't want to give now. I'm too tired. This talk is really, really good. This thoracic outlet tumors is, I will talk about all the incisions that are used for resecting a thoracic outlet tumor some other day. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. All right. Yeah, no problem.
Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot. Anybody has
thank
any
you, sir.
Pressing questions which you want to ask? Before I sign out,
no, sir. Thank you very much.
Can we can reserve it for some other day.
Yeah, 4.5 hours. Okay, nobody's
going to do four. Too much.
Much appreciated. Really appreciated.
But I can take one or two questions really quickly before we sign out. Come on, quickly. Anybody's got something which they can't sleep over?
from the morning lecture. About the thoracic outlet. Sir, we said that one of the differential is cervical disc prolapse or cervical spine pathology. Are we supposed to do any tests for the same in the exam or are we?
No. You're not an orthopedic surgeon. So we don't expect you to do that sort of stuff.
Okay.
You can do it. It's not difficult. You just have to do extension, flexion, lateral rotation and things. Those are all very specific. Okay. But you're not a... This is not an orthopedics exam, so we are not expecting you to do that. But for nerve and vascular things, we want you to do the test.
Okay.
So if you guys want, I can put all these videos up one by one, or if you want, you can go through my lecture again. I went through two times during the lecture purely because nobody remembers it until and unless you see it yourself and you do it yourself. So my suggestion is get somebody to sit with you and you do these tests. This is the best case to get in the exam. You'll crack it. You'll absolutely crack it. Because you actually do the test and you show and you talk as I spoke, you know. Why are you doing the test? You lift the hand because you want to reduce the compression at this level. So talk about the three levels of compression and then very, very clearly mention what is happening at each level. Okay?
Sir?
Yeah, Kriti, tell me.
Sir, why do we want to see the adrenals in the CT? In the mediastinal mass.
Lung cancer frequently metastasizes to adrenals. So it's a very close correlation with the lung cancer and adrenal metastases. And sometimes if you've got a single metastasis in the adrenal, that's called as an oligometastasis. And so in that situation, either you take out the adrenal first, followed by lung surgery, or you actually do both the surgeries at the same sitting. So you can do a laparoscopic adrenalectomy and a VATS lobectomy. And that is shown to have better outcomes for these patients. Okay. Kriti, welcome
to
the group. Kriti is one of my students and she has now got selected for general surgical and cardiothoracic training eventually in the US on the national training program. So well done, Kriti. And
thank you so much, sir.
You must join this group. It's not all about cardiac. You know, life is also about
yes, sir.
One day you will do a little bit of thoracic. So good.
Thank you so much, sir.
Kriti is from Nepal and she's got into a very good center in the US. So well done. Okay.
Thank you so much, sir.
4.5 hours, for God's sake. That is too
much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.